Hey everybody, and welcome back to Limbo. This is part 3 of this playthrough. Oh, I love that rain sound. So echoey, like it's really hitting the metal roofs, which you didn't get in the foresty areas. It's been a little while since I played the last section, so let me just try and remember what the controls are. Hopefully control... Okay, so we're going to be carrying on this playthrough, stopping whenever we come across anything interesting, anything that sort of reflects the any way in which the world design or the mechanics, and this is going to collapse on me. It's a nice touch there. Anyway, the puzzles, the world design, anyway it helps reinforce the narrative and the theme that the game is trying to put across. That's what this gameplay is really all about. Nice little clue there as to what you've got to do to get through this section. And again, the sound effect, very high pitched against what's previously been a very low pitched area. Makes it very clear to the player what they're supposed to be doing. I think it's easier if I start on this side of it. See, as I said at the end of the last video, we've passed my favourite point of the game, I think. And I'm trying to work out kind of why that's the case. Because the game's still enjoyable from here on out, don't get me wrong. I think I'm going to die. Nope, I made it. It's a lovely little transition there, because you know that there's no way back from here. Let you know that you've started a new area, probably going to come across some new mechanics. And the echo that you get on everything really gives you an idea of how open this space is. And there's that arrow that fell down before. Which is kind of pointing, suggesting we should go up. But that's not the case here. I can't remember why I needed to go that way, but I do remember I needed to knock this down first. Ah. I think, because suddenly we've got a shaft of life here, shaft of light, that should give me a clue as to why I needed to get through this way, and why I needed to go that way first, when I still had a chance to retreat. Because if we go across here, we're going to see another one of these brain worms. And if I hadn't gone this way first, I would have run into this thing and those buckets would have fallen down and killed me. So I don't really remember what I've got to do here. I can't remember if this is a fairly short section like this, or if this is going to be a prolonged section. But I do think that we pretty soon we enter more of a sort of factory area. So yeah, I've got a crate down beneath me now. I don't think we've seen these elevators before. What do we want to do here? I think that might have been a mistake. I think we probably... Yeah, that was a mistake. That was definitely a mistake. So yeah, we've entered the factory. And I remember now, one of the many reasons why I didn't enjoy this section so much. It's because I died a lot, and these deaths just seem particularly graphic. So I think I want to go slowly over this thing. Yeah, I know you've got to time it. Definitely, if I wasn't slowing down here. Yeah, so I need to time it just right, so that I can climb onto the box and jump over the spinning blade. Just like that. I think I've got to go backwards now. I'm pretty sure that if I fall down here it's going to kill me. Yeah, let's hope I don't have to do that whole section again. So I think in the previous areas, a lot of the puzzles have been kind of things where you get caught out first time, but then you learn how they're done. You learn what things to avoid, and there's no problem. I think from here on out, there's a lot more timing puzzles where you've got to make sure you get the timing right. Not like that. Definitely not like that. And in the first section, it's not so bad for me, because I'm a terrible game player. But I can be reasonably observant. But from here on out, observation isn't enough. You've actually got to be able to play video games. Which is kind of where I fall down. Which I guess is why I'm doing a video series on game narratives as an excuse to play things on easy mode. I got Dark Souls 3 for Christmas, I've been playing through that at the moment. I really respect the Dark Souls games for how difficult they are, or at least for how challenging they are. Difficult's the wrong word, because they are always very fair. But I am one of the people who wishes there was an easy mode. I think I can just start. I don't think I've got to go all the way to the bottom. I think I can just. Yeah, that's better. There's supposed to be four main sorts of gamers, four different reasons people play games. Social, challenge, exploration, and something else. And I think the Dark Souls games are really geared towards the people who want the challenge, whereas I'm much more about the exploration. I mean, I'm not the worst. I do enjoy the challenge of Dark Souls. I do feel rewarded. I do feel happy when I get through a section. I don't think. Let me see, how do I do this? Yeah, like that. And I think we're coming across another new mechanic here, which plays quite a role for, I think, the rest of the game, really. Nope. It's not what I was thinking. Oh, I'm going to have to do this, aren't I? So I should probably talk a little bit about the area we're in, because it's changed quite dramatically to areas we've been in previously. So this is a sort of a factory area. We can see there's an ongoing theme of these horrible, horrible spinning blade things. I'm trying to remember what I've got to do here. I know it's something about the... Once you step on one of these platforms, that blade's going to start coming across, and you need to time these two boxes. Not like that, though. Not like that at all. Again, I'm sure that somewhere around here, way too early. The problem I have with this area is that when you finish a section like this, there is nothing to do except kill yourself. And I just didn't like purposefully throwing the boy into those spinning blades over and over. Yeah, I'm sure there must be some sort of clue in the background. Like maybe those are the right distance apart, that they're not. I just feel like there's the more humane way to go. The crunch of the bones is still not particularly nice, but I'd rather do that than... Okay. So yeah, that's how you do it. We're still sort of blending. I mean, even in between these areas with the spinning blades, I'm sure there was some sort of grassy outside areas. We've not left the outside world completely. I think. So this is a bit of the game that I've never actually done before. Those little egg things that you crack on, their achievements, once you've collected all of them, this door will open, and I believe there's a secret area behind there, which I've not seen before at all. I only actually found out about it because of YouTube. I know inside's got something similar. I found the secret area, I just didn't find all of the achievements. I know inside there's something really interesting with the secret areas. I really don't want to spoil. I'm curious to see what with the Limbos does something that good. Okay, so we've got another insect here. I'm trying to work out how the spider... I know the spider's not an insect. I'm trying to work out how the spider and this sort of tie together thematically with this idea of loneliness and sort of edge of death thing. So you've got to wait for him to settle back down, get a little bit closer. And there we go. Because again, we're tearing the limbs off them, which is definitely a callback to what happened before. See, look at the way it twitches. It's horrible. And in the spider section, that made a lot of sense, because you had this relentless horror chasing you, and you had to take it apart piece by piece. And at the end of it, you'd survived, but you'd kind of become a little bit of a monster yourself. Because you eventually had to roll its corpse over some spikes in order to get along. And this section here, I mean, you're also, once again, you're just using the insect, damaging it in the process. Not the nicest of people. But I can't say I'm 100% on how it really ties in. That was lovely then, that change in the sound effect, because we had this... I didn't even notice the sort of background tone playing until I stepped on this thing and it cut out and said, look, you're in a new section, new puzzles, new mechanics. So we've got a section coming up soon with a lot of these cogs, and this is the first time that I've really noticed how huge this one is compared to the boy. A big signal as to what's going to be coming up soon. And that was me forgetting my left and right. So I think this area is really clever in the puzzle. Oh, no. Oh. I think the puzzle design in this area is really clever, but I don't feel it ties in as well to all this idea of loneliness. And although, having said that, I can see this as sort of very automated factory. I think what I want to do... is get on this side. Was that not as far as it could go? I didn't bring it back in, did I? Let's try again. So yeah, you've got this factory running, which is certainly a sign that there's been people here, but it's all automated now. There is nobody there. It is just a big empty world you're in. Oh no, what I need to do is grab that. I forgot. Oh. Thank you. I really like how angry that sounds. I mean, it definitely sounds like it's angry at you. For not letting it do its job. There's a lot of weight to the levers in this, which is really nice. It's not just flipping a switch, it's flipping a switch and waiting for whatever that's going to cause. There is a lot of waiting in this game. I mean, deliberately so. Oh, that was... actually, no. That wasn't an error. What I find interesting here is how greyed out this thing is, because it's... we've seen these things before. But it looks almost part of the background here. No, that was the wrong button. That was me. See, that's the thing, I'm really bad at video games, and this section, or this rest of the game, kind of is about being better at video games. What do I do here? Oh yeah. So here we're going back into something that I really understand what it's doing. Like this game loves to make you wait, and this section is all about that. Because the world changes so slowly that you're never sure what you're supposed to be doing for a little while. And once you do know, you've only got a short amount of time to react to it. Because I know I'm going to go through here, but I don't know what's going to be coming across. But once I get there, suddenly this platform becomes viable. I know I keep pointing this out, but once again, Playdead have done a really good job of making sure the player is knowing exactly what's going on with the sound effects. There's not a lot of background noise. All the things the player needs to know about in the puzzle are making some sort of sound. Speaking of making some sort of sound, I don't know if they might pick that up, but my cat is apparently quite hungry. I really like this here, because you can't really tell if that's a huge blade in the background or just the really threatening shadow of this thing. What we're going to see here is similar to what happened in the last video, where we've had a few different mechanics put in place. We've had the spinning blades before, we've had the electric rails, we've had these crates, and the gravity changes. And we're about to combine all of that together to make sure the player has learned what's going on. And again, it's going so slowly that you're forced to wait, forced to see what's going on, and then react to it kind of at the last minute. Nope. I thought the world was going to turn a little bit faster. I thought I had to be on the other side of the box. And the noises, it gets so loud during these dangerous sections. Everything seems much more threatening, and I don't notice the sounds picking up until suddenly it's deafening. In fact, for the second time this video, I'm going to have to turn the volume of my headphones down. And it's gone quiet, and everything's stopped, and it's given you just a little bit of breathing room before you see that that's all going to happen again. And it's giving you a little bit of time just to work out what you think might happen. So, curved corner here, something's probably going to have to go around there. Now we've got this boulder here. We saw earlier in the game what boulders do, just in case we didn't have a working knowledge of physics. There's a crate above us, which we're going to have to be careful of, because it will fall on our heads. Yeah, if we didn't plan that right, then any number of things there could have killed us. The world seems to have stopped. We've got a rather shaky light here. I see a little white thing fluttering around there. Makes me wonder if there's going to be more of these worms coming up. I do believe it's coming up to one of my favourite thematic moments in the game. Yeah. So, Limbo is, in theory, the story of a boy trying to rescue his sister. Now, that's not explained anywhere in the game. The only reason I know that is because it says so in every article I've read about this, every developer interview, every... It's common knowledge that Limbo is about a boy trying to rescue his sister, even though it's only very, very vaguely hinted at in the game. But here we have what looks to be the end of the game. But no. And in a brilliant, brilliant twist, the world behind us has changed. Which you will see when I survive. No, oh. If you ever want to talk about loneliness as the theme of this game, that moment there is probably the best example. You finally get a chance of seeing somebody that you actually, who actually would probably want to see you. But you're turned away from her. And when you try to go back, she's not there anymore. So this is one of the reasons why I've always thought of this as being kind of a dream, a coma patient's dream sort of thing. Oh, damn it, I forgot. I can't go backwards. Because of that one section there where reality just shifts. I'm going to try and do here. Nope, not that time. Nope. No, I need to be on a box. Hopefully from this box. What I'm trying to do is get across here. Oh, I think I left that too late. I definitely left that. Oh. You don't have to go back, but if you go up the ladder there, then you can get to an achievement that you'll see later on. And I do kind of want to see what this secret level's going to be like. Nope. So let's ignore that for now, because I don't want this video to go on for too long, and I will definitely spend the rest of the night trying to get that. So yeah, you see that egg right there? Gotta go around the apartment way to get it. That was... Too soon. Oh no, now I remember. This is a horrible section. I need that going the other way around. But I need this. Like that. I think here's a good place to end it for this run through. Let's see how far through we are. So yeah, we started here, about halfway through. Now we've gone through all of these sections. We've got this wonderful, wonderful section coming up soon. Love what they do with the lighting in this next bit. And I think that's where we'll take it from next time. So thanks for watching, and please like and subscribe, and join me next time for the last in this, what's going to be a four-part series, it seems.